Hey, good morning, church. It's a beautiful day to worship God together, and we are so glad that you have joined us online to worship together. Our goal, as always, is to make this a time where we honor the Lord and that we can do that as interactively as possible while we're online like this. And so we would encourage you, as we prepare to get into our worship, to, if you have any prayer requests or praises that you would like to share, you can go ahead and put those as a Facebook comment. Pastor Dave is monitoring those, and then he'll be able to incorporate those into his prayer time a little bit later in our worship time. We do take communion each time that we gather for worship, and so we'll do that online as well here. If you have an opportunity to grab a piece of bread or a cup of water, a cup of juice, then I'll lead us in taking communion a little bit later in the service as well. But we are blessed. Our God is good. Our God loves us. And so if you haven't heard it yet this morning, you are deeply, deeply loved. Our God pours his love out on us as new mercies every day. And so we give him thanks and we praise his name. So let me offer this these words from Scripture. This is actually taken from Psalm 18 for our call to worship this morning. You, Lord, keep my lamp burning. My God turns my darkness into light. For God's way is perfect. The Lord's word is flawless. He shields all who take refuge in him. The Lord lives. Praise be to my rock. Exalted be God my Savior. And therefore I will praise you, Lord, among the nations. I will sing the praises of your name. Let's worship him this day, church.
Children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory. just are saved, find their way at the sound of your great name. All condemned, feel no shame at the sound of your great name. Every fear has no place.
have prayer joys and concerns that have been passed in by email and text and verbally shared with the pastoral staff. Also, we've received comments on Facebook from the live stream. And I'm going to lead us in prayer in just a minute, but I want to invite you to join me in your hearts to pray on your own, however God prompts you, as we share together in this time of prayer. I'm going to be leading our prayer time with a pattern of prayer following the letters of the word pray, P-R-A-Y, and each of those letters representing a different pattern or type of prayer. P representing praise to God, R representing repenting or repentance before God, A representing ask, and Y representing yielding to God. I want to encourage you to pray on your own in your own heart as I offer suggestions as we're praying. Praise. As I'm praying, I invite you to express your own praise to God in your own heart, however He prompts you. We praise you, God Almighty. You are the loving, sovereign, holy one. You are good, and you're our Heavenly Father, and you do not change. You alone are eternal, everlasting, and exalted. We praise you with our lives. We lift our hands in your name, and we praise your holy name. Repent. As we continue on in our prayers, I invite you to talk to God in your own heart about your own life, however He prompts you. We pray, observing the pattern of Paul in Ephesians 1:18, when he says, I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which you are called. Lord, that hope is that you will help us in our sin. Lord, I confess my sin, and I repent, and I seek your mercy, washing, and cleansing. It's only by the blood of Jesus that we have any hope of forgiveness and cleansing. We don't deserve it. We can't earn it. We can't pay it back. It's just by grace. Ask. As we continue on in our prayer time, I invite you to talk to God in your own heart, asking Him for whatever He prompts you to ask Him for. Thank you for this church family, God, and for the opportunity to share together on our spiritual journey. Thank you for each person, because each one is valuable and important and significant. We give you praise, along with Tom and Mary Maxwell, for their great-granddaughter Zoe, who had been healed from an abscess in her lungs. Praise God for your touch and for your deliverance for that concern for which we have prayed. We give you praise, God, along with Vinette Davis at Aspen, shared that a baby that she was caring for and the baby's mom that had been in the hospital have been released to go home. We give you praise along with Deanna Nelson for her mom, Naomi, after her successful hip surgery last week. And she thanks us for our prayers. And now we pray for Naomi's healing and recovery. God is good. Thank you, Lord, for your touch for her. We pray along with Jan Moeller for her brother, Jack Cornett, as he has his last four radiation treatments this coming week, and then a CT scan scheduled for May 20th. We're praying that the treatments work. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to lift him before the throne. We pray for Delicia McBlair as she recovers after brain tumor surgery on Friday. Help her and her family as she heals and relearns things. We pray along with Rex Keister for his son, Justin Keister. He's had a tumor removed recently that was determined to be malignant. We pray for him as he awaits scheduling of an MRI to see if the cancer may have spread. We pray for Justin and his family, Elise and daughter Cora, as they live in the Manhattan area. We continue to pray for Roger Creer for healing and recovering now that he is home from the hospital after his battle with COVID-19. We pray for his complete recovery. We continue to pray along with others for Bill Sherlock as he continues to recover after heart surgery recently. We pray for Michael and Susan Cochran that we heard about last week, and we pray for their approval to be able to return to the mission field soon. Be with them. We pray for all those who have been challenged by this health crisis virus. We pray for all our government leaders at the national, state, and local level to have wisdom. We pray for emergency responders and doctors and nurses and medical staff and all that they do. We pray for all the students and educators and administrators as they adjust to these changes. And we pray for many people to be moved to realize their need for God and to be saved during these trying times. We pray for Cliff Hagee today as he'll be sharing your word. Fill him, anoint him, use him, allow him to be a channel of your truth, and may your spirit be present to prompt the heart of each one who hears, that we may know what it is that you're prompting us as the next step for each of us on our spiritual journey. We all have different journeys, but we all have a next step, and we pray for your help, whatever that next step may be. We want to pray for the families of those who have experienced passing of loved ones. We pray for the family of 30-year-old Blake Mays, Beloit High School 2008 graduate, who passed away following a shooting in Wichita last week. Send comfort and peace to his family. And we pray along with Rachel Ducote for separate events in Osborne County last week in which two people passed away and one's in a Wichita hospital. Send comfort and peace for all those that were affected by those situations. Yield, as we continue on in our prayer time, I invite you to talk to God in your own heart, yielding to him however he prompts you. God, we pray that you would remove the eclipse from our spiritual eyes. The words of the song that Michael Smith has written, "Open the eyes of my heart," represent my prayer of yielding to you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, "Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy," we cry. "Holy, holy, holy. You are holy, holy, holy. I just want to see you." I pray all these things in the name of our risen Lord, Master, and Savior Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Dave. I'd like to take just a little time to get our minds and hearts prepared to receive communion. And so if you have your communion elements, you could go ahead and gather those and be ready for that. Just thinking about this the other day, you ever been working maybe at home or at work where you've been so involved in a project that you without even realizing it, you kind of blew through one or even two meal times because you were so focused on what needed to be done? And for me, when I miss a few meals, it doesn't take too long before my body lets me know that. That it's not only just a grumbling in my belly, but there's kind of an overall weakness that starts to hit. I call it to my wife, Laura, I say, "I'm feeling a little shaky, getting a little shaky," and it feels like I've lost the energy that certainly food does provide. You get a little hangry sometimes. Your attitude changes just a bit. There's a real profound impact when our bodies don't receive the food that it needs to survive day by day. One solution for me is just eating a quart of ice cream pretty much does away with that, but only temporarily. Because when I do that, of course, I feel that rush of, oh, I've got the energy I need, but then you get that big drop-off that they call a sugar crash, where your body thought it had what it needed, but it didn't last. And then you're worse off than you were in the first place. And what your body is really saying, of course, at that point is, I need real food. In John chapter 6, Jesus offended many people because he began to talk about, this is probably the earliest part of where we see Jesus referencing his body and his blood. And in John 6, he offended people because he said, "My body is real food, and my blood is real drink." And people were offended by that, and Jesus was trying to explain what he meant by that. But at the very bottom of it, let me just read this verse from that chapter, John 6, verse 53. Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you." And one of the great reminders that for me of communion is I am needy. I'm a person who cannot survive very long without physical food, and Jesus tells us very clearly we cannot live, truly live, without him, without taking him in. in a very real way. We grow weak and we die unless we take in the Son of Man, Jesus Christ. So communion is this opportunity for us to say kind of a confession. Lord, we need you. We're not afraid to say that. We're not ashamed to say that. But your life in us is what really gives us the fullest life now and eternal life forever. And so we're happy when we come to the table, when we remember Jesus, his sacrifice for us, giving us his life in a very real way. And the beauty of communion for me is also this. Jesus uses the metaphor of food, that his life is food for our souls in the same way that we had taken physical food into our bodies. And when you think about that metaphor, to eat is not a chore. For most of us, eating is a joy. For most of us, food has great pleasure as we take it in. I've never heard anybody say, oh gosh, I'm so excited because I have to fill up my gas tank. Even though gas prices are lower than they have been in 20 years, but nobody gets excited about having to fill that tank. But most of us say there's a great joy and pleasure in taking in the food that we need to sustain our lives. And so in the same way, I think Jesus is trying to say communion, although it's somber in one sense, we remember a great sacrifice, that he bore our suffering, our punishment in his own body and with his own blood shed for us. But at the same time, it's a great joy, and there's pleasure in receiving Jesus in, his life working into our lives at the very deepest levels. And so I would encourage you as we take communion today to remember we need him, but it's a pleasure, it's a joy to take him in. And so Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, he had gathered his disciples for the Passover meal, and he redefines the Passover. He points to the fact that all the Passovers that had ever been taken were actually pointing to him in fulfillment of him. And so Jesus on that night, when he took bread, after he had given thanks, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you." And in the same way, Jesus then took the cup and he said to his disciples, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. So take and drink in remembrance of Jesus." God fills us up. He provides all that we need. And now as I turn our attention to thinking about a time of offering, I would just tell you again, we're very, very encouraged faithfulness of you, the church, in continuing to give. We know that many are in very precarious times in terms of their work, their job, and income. And so we're blessed to see God's people continue to give generously. Let me read a verse from 1 Timothy 6, verses 6 and 7, where the Apostle Paul writes to Timothy and he says, "But godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into the world and we can take nothing out of it." There's a great contentment that comes with giving. But the giving, I think, is the key for that, as Paul mentions here, is that we don't actually own any of it. What we give is actually, as a steward or a manager would give, something that's not ours, but we give it in stewardship of the owner, the master. And I was thinking about that and reflecting a little bit on that, that how much anxiety comes along with ownership. When you don't own something that you're using, you're kind of carefree with it. You have this sense of just enjoying the thing itself. But when ownership comes, there comes a lot of anxiety. We start getting insurance on things because we're afraid if we lose it, we'll have some way to get it back. We protect it. We're protective of the things that we own. And yet here Paul is saying the Christian life is this beautiful freedom in knowing I don't own anything. Even my very life is given to me. And it belongs to my Creator. And so we have this freedom in which we live, and now we don't take a passive approach to these things, but we say, I can let go of a good thing. The things themselves are not bad, but I let go of good things to gain a greater thing, but not a thing, a person. And so Paul says we have this great ability to have contentment along with the godliness that we have in Christ. So as non-owners of anything, I would encourage you to experience the freedom and joy of contentment in giving those things as good stewards. And so we invest into the kingdom of God. We give so that we have this sense of, I don't gain more myself, but the kingdom continues to increase. And then we have the joy of the servants. So when Jesus comes to those servants who have taken what he's given them and they've invested it and they've doubled it, and he has that great word to his servants who do that, well done, good and faithful servants. I've entrusted you with a little, and now I'm going to give you much more. And so with that kind of contentment and joy, I would encourage you to continue to give as we now continue to worship through this next praise song.
Even at my worst, I know you're with me. Promise I will never be alone. Even when I walk into the valley, you won't let me go. Every word you whisper draws me deeper. Break the lies and fill my heart with truth. You are faithful and you are my keeper. I'm safe here with you.
Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is fire. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is prayer.
Well, church, I hope you're hungry for God's Word this morning, and so I want to encourage you, if you have a Bible there at home, you can follow along as I'm going to look into Acts chapter 12, starting at verse 25, so the very last verse of that chapter, and then into chapter 13, Acts 13 through verse 12 of that chapter. We are in a series called Led by the Spirit, and so our goal in this series is to look at something that Romans 8 talks about, which is the children of God are led by the Spirit. Those who are led by the Spirit are children of God. And what does that look like in our lives? How do we be led by the Spirit? So we're looking at an example from the book of Acts of how people were led by the Spirit. The texts that we're looking at in this series are primarily what's called Paul's first missionary journey. And last week we kind of saw the beginnings of the church where Paul was sent out, which was the church at Antioch. And we read more about that church today and the actual sending out on that first journey. So follow along as I read Acts 12, 25 through 13, verse 12, remembering, of course, this is God's Word. And so listen for the Holy Spirit to speak as we look into His Word. When Barnabas and Saul had finished their mission, they returned from Jerusalem, taking with them John, also called Mark. Now in the church at Antioch, there were prophets and teachers: Barnabas, Simeon called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manion, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. And while they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them." And so after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and they sent them off. The two of them, sent on their way by the Holy Spirit, went down to Seleucia and sailed there from there to Cyprus. And when they arrived at Salamis, they proclaimed the word of God in the Jewish synagogues, and John was with them as their helper. They traveled through the whole island until they came to Paphos, and there they met a Jewish sorcerer and false prophet named Bar-Jesus, who was an attendant of the proconsul Sergius Paulus. The proconsul, an intelligent man, sent for Barnabas and Saul because he wanted to hear the word of God. But Elymas, the sorcerer, for that is what his name means, opposed them and tried to turn the proconsul from the faith. And then Saul, who was also called Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, looked straight at Elymas and said, "You are a child of the devil and an enemy of everything that is right. You are full of all kinds of deceit and trickery. Will you never stop perverting the right ways of the Lord? And now the hand of the Lord is against you. You are going to be blind for a time, not even able to see the light of the sun." Immediately, mist and darkness came over him, and he groped about, seeking someone to lead him by the hand. And when the proconsul saw what had happened, he believed, for he was amazed at the teaching about the Lord. Let's take a moment to pray. Father, we always pause because it's our opportunity to remember and confess our need for you. We can read words, but Lord, it doesn't have power unless your Holy Spirit speaks them into our minds and our hearts, into our lives. And so our prayer is simple, but we pray powerful by your hand, that you would work this word into our lives in such a way that we are not the same. We don't want to go through the motions, God, of just reading your word and going through the motions of worship. We want to be changed by you for your glory, for our good and our joy. We pray this would happen in Jesus' name. Amen. So in this series where we're trying to discern, how does the Holy Spirit lead us as believers today? One of the things that we pick up, and I'll just kind of look at 3 points today, two points that we'll focus on. Before the Holy Spirit leads us, we also have to come to grips with how do we hear the Holy Spirit. We can't be led by the Holy Spirit, in fact, unless we are actually hearing from the Holy Spirit. We're sensing, perceiving what the Spirit is saying to us, and then able to act on that. And so in our text today, I want to look at two points of context for how this church and those within the church, and then specifically Paul and Barnabas, heard the Holy Spirit, the context for hearing God speak to us, and then one point on how the Holy Spirit leads, because he begins to lead in this journey and their first stop on the island of Cyprus. So just a couple of points here, first about the context in which they hear God speak to them. And the context, actually Luke, who wrote the book of Acts, he wrote the Gospel of Luke and his companion volume, the book of Acts. Luke tells us some details about this church. And always remember, when we're reading Scripture, when you see some of these details, they seem sometimes as unimportant, but the writers of Scripture were very, very intentional. They don't add these things just kind of filler. In fact, they were very concise in terms of how they wrote and what they wrote. So when we see Luke give us, and I'll just read these verses again, verse 26 and verse 1 of chapter 13. Just a reminder, back in Acts 11 from last week, we said at Antioch the Christians were first called, it was at Antioch the disciples were first called Christians. But then at this church at Antioch, it says, in the church at Antioch there were prophets and teachers, and then Luke names them. But he gives some details about them, just a little bit. Barnabas, we know, is from Cyprus. We're told that he's from Cyprus. That's where they're going to go, the first leg of their journey. And that means that Barnabas is a bicultural Jew. He's what the scriptures often talked about as a Hellenistic Jew. You see that earlier in the book of Acts. That means that he's a Jew, but he's raised in a very Greek-oriented culture, and so he's bicultural. It also says there was Simeon called Niger. And the word there actually refers to that he would be black, that this Simeon was actually someone probably from Africa, a black African. And then he tells us there's Lucius of Cyrene. Cyrene would be where modern-day Libya is located. So we have Cyrus, he's a Libyan. And then we're told that there's Manian, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch. And by the way, this Herod is a reference to Herod Antipas, who is the one that John the Baptist criticized and then had John the Baptist beheaded. He was a very wicked ruler. He was someone who ruled with a kind of an iron fist, and John the Baptist spoke against him. Jesus called this Herod a fox. He knew he was very sly in trying to get what he wanted. And so this particular person, Manian, it says, was brought up with Herod. And that means that Manian was at the upper crust. He was the upper class. He would have been raised in a very different way than most people living in the household with Herod. And then there was Saul, also known as Paul, who was this incredibly educated Pharisee, Jewish rabbi, who was like a lawyer. He knew the law inside and out. And so you have this collection of individuals that Luke specifically names, and I think Luke does it to really get this point across. The church at Antioch was a very diverse community. It was one church, but it has a lot of diversity in it. It was the first, in one sense, multi-ethnic, multinational, multi-class church in history. And why is that important? I think the reason that this is important, and by the way, the reason that believers were first called Christians at Antioch is for this very reason of diversity. Previous to this, you have, if you were Roman, you had Roman religion. If you were Greek, you had Greek religion. If you happened to live in Ephesus, you worshipped the local deity there, Artemis. You had local gods that people worshipped. So it depended on where you came from or your ethnic background, that determined your religion. But for the first time in history, you have a group of people who are brought across all of those lines. Different ethnicities, different nations, different locations, different backgrounds culturally, and they all come together into one church. And how does that, the only way they could describe them then wasn't as Greek or Jew or Roman. They could describe them only as what's the one common denominator that they all have. And it's Jesus, the Christ. And so they became known as Christians. It was actually a reflection of their diversity, their unity with all this diversity. And so Luke is making this point here because the unity that is happening here is critical to us hearing God speak. When we think of unity that God brings, he brings all kinds of different people together into the church. And you might think, well, maybe that's for God's, you know, good, that God is like a parent who just is trying to get his kids to kind of get along, you know. It's really not so much for God's benefit as much as it is for ours. Because there's something that happens when we are together with people who are not exactly like us, who have this diversity coming together. This diversity gives us the ability to hear the fullness of the Holy Spirit speak into our lives. It's absolutely critical that we have people who are not like us, who are believers in Christ in our lives, if we're really going to hear the fullness of the Spirit. C.S. Lewis put it this way once. He said, remember, C.S. Lewis was just a real famous Christian author, but he was part of a group of writers and who were called the Inklings, and they had this kind of little social club that they had, and J.R.R. Tolkien was a part of that, and Charles Williams was another author who was a part of that, and they had this great fellowship and connection and friendship that they had together. Well, Charles Williams died unexpectedly, and it was a real grieving moment for C.S. Lewis and the others, and C.S. Lewis wrote about that. He said it was very interesting as they were mourning Charles's passing. He said he noticed something. He noticed that in each, this is what he writes, in each of my friends, there is something that only some other friend can fully bring out in them. By myself, I am not large enough to call the whole man into activity. And he noticed that the way that Charles used to joke with, like, Tolkien brought out of Tolkien, but also revealed something about Charles that could not be revealed just in C.S. Lewis's relationship with Charles Williams alone. He said, watching him interact with my other friends, I saw a fullness in Charles that I could not have had just by myself. Lewis is saying that it takes community of friends to know the fullness of the individual within that group. That's why I think, and we've experienced this, I know you've experienced this, it's a powerful thing when a loved one passes away. What happens as we meet, we grieve and we mourn? We tell stories, don't we? We tell stories of the person. And one of the most precious things is for a family whose loved one has passed, when they hear a story that they hadn't heard about their loved one who made an impact in someone's life, and it blesses them so much. And I think a part of that, a big part of that, is that they're able to see something about their loved one that they did not see before. And if that is true on a human level between us in terms of our relationships, then how much more true would it be that I can't really know and hear the fullness of God without the people of God in my life? The diversity of the people of God, that your interaction and relationship with God in some way begins to reveal something about God that I am not able to see all on my own. And I believe this is exactly why Luke stresses here. Here's a church that's able to hear what the Holy Spirit is saying to them, but it's because in part of this great diversity that they have, even while they have a great unity together. And by the way, this is why missions is so important for the local church. The reason that we emphasize missions and sending missionaries is not just because we realize the Great Commission and we can't be over in some of these other areas in the world, and so we want to support those who can go and are called to go, but it's also, we don't want to just be a sending church, we have to be a receiving church. And that means we're able to hear through our missionaries how our brothers and sisters throughout the world who are so different from us, their culture is different, their language is different, all these things that are different from them, and yet we all share this one common bond in Christ. It's so critical that I hear from them So we're a sending church in missions, but we need to be a receiving church in missions to hear the fullness of God at work throughout our world through other believers who are so different than ourselves. And I think Luke is making this point by listing out these folks and saying, do you see how diverse this church is? This is in part why they were able to hear the Spirit, and then they're going to be led by the Spirit. But there's a second point of context here for listening and hearing the Holy Spirit speak. It says, verses 2 and 3 of Acts 13, while they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. And so after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off. So here's a church. The picture is a church that is waiting for God to speak. They have this sense, and maybe you're not sure exactly why, what are they waiting for? Why would they be prompted to be in this mode of listening? Of course, we always want to be listening for the Holy Spirit, but it's not a passive waiting. Notice that what they're doing is not just passively waiting for God to speak, but they're actually actively waiting for the Holy Spirit to speak. And here's where it's a good point for us to consider. When we talk about God speaking, it's a point of frustration for many, many people because they say, I don't hear God speak. I want to hear God speak, but I never hear God speak. And I hear testimonies of people saying, God spoke to me. I felt like God was leading me and doing, and I don't get that. So it's very frustrating. But part of it could be in the way in which we are seeking to hear God speak. And part of it, I think, comes down to a heart attitude. So if I were to say, do you want to hear God speak to you in your life? I think most people will say, well, of course. Who wouldn't want to hear God speak to them? But consider the various motives or reasonings behind why somebody would say, I want to hear God speak. I think one reason that some people may want to hear God speak is as a test of God. They are actually testing God. They're saying, God, everybody says you're real. But here's the thing, you have to prove yourself to me. So if you want me to really follow you, then you're going to have to prove it by speaking to me. The Holy Spirit wants to speak to me, here I am. He knows where I'm at. And that kind of attitude really reveals that we don't really want to hear from God as much as we want to test God. There's another reason that we might actually miss in terms of seeking to hear the Holy Spirit speak. And that would be what I call kind of the Google approach to God. You know, nowadays, if you don't know something, what's the first thing everybody turns to? You just Google it, right? And some people, when they say, I want to hear God speak, it's primarily saying, I want God to give me information, like Google. I just kind of type it in and boom, I get the information that I need. God, I want you to do it that way. I'll ask you questions. I'll ask you for information. And I want to hear you speak primarily so you can give me the answer. And that's a very limiting way to consider how to listen for the Holy Spirit to speak. Or it might be the Netflix approach, which is, I want to hear God speak for entertainment purposes, or almost the bucket list kind of way. Like people think, oh, I would want to hear God speak because I could check that off on my bucket list. How great would that be to hear God speak to me? Of course, it reveals a misunderstanding because when you see in Scripture where God does speak to people, almost always it flattens them out in fear. It absolutely awestrucks them. It's just so awesome in when it happens. It's not an entertaining thing. It's an awesome thing. But some people say, I would just like to have that experience of it. But these people at the Church of Antioch who are listening to be led by the Spirit are not listening for information or entertainment. They're listening, and this is the key, for relationship. And we know that because they are worshiping the Lord in their waiting. And worship is a very intimate term. It's a term of relationship that says, I'm in this relationship with a holy God who's awesome, but also who's close and near to me, who's imminent, who's come near to sinners like me. And so there's this bond and connection. I want to know, this is what the church was really listening for. And it's a different kind of listening. I'm listening not for information, not for entertainment. I'm listening for the heart of God. I can't be led by God's Spirit unless I know what God's heart is. And once I know God's heart, then suddenly the voice of the Spirit becomes a lot more clear. But until I seek Him for Him, not for what He can give me, then I think our listening for God is going to be frustrated to some degree. And they're not only worshiping the Lord, they're fasting. In other words, Luke is saying, this church is so hungry to hear God speak to them, they're willing to do without food. They're willing to kind of bring their focal point away from the normal, good, ordinary things of life for something even better. God, I want to hear You speak, and I'm going to fast and worship and pray and do these things to know Your heart. Advertisers have noticed that consumers like choices. They do. They said when you offer consumers choices, they really like that. It kind of spurs the buying impulse in us. But then they've also noticed, as they've done studies, if you present too many options to consumers, it overwhelms them, and their brains aren't able to process it, and they usually come away with buyer's remorse. And it's very interesting, as they were talking about that, when you think about this, if you get sent to the store to pick up something, and somebody says, well, I want you to pick up some Crest toothpaste for me. Did you know that there are 27, I'm not even joking, there's 27 varieties of Crest toothpaste? How many varieties do you need to brush your teeth? Did you know that if somebody, hey, just pick up some Tide laundry detergent at the store, that there are 11 different variations of Tide laundry detergent? And I don't even like Cheerios, but I'm looking at Cheerios here. There are original Cheerios, there's toasted coconut Cheerios, there's blueberry, maple, Cheerios, oat crunch, there's gluten-free Cheerios, there's honey nut Cheerios, there's multigrain, apple cinnamon, fruity Cheerios, frosted Cheerios, banana nut, pumpkin spice, and chocolate Cheerios. And when you see all those options, and they say, it just kind of overloads your brain. Of course, if you heard chocolate, that's the only one you need at the end there. But if your brain is overloaded with all these different options, at some point, to actually function well, you have to sweep away all of the peripherals. You have to focus down and say, no, this is the one that's worth having. In the same way, that's what all the spiritual disciplines are. All the spiritual disciplines are not ends in themselves. They are the broom of our life that says, these are good things, but I'm going to have to push them to the side, because to focus on that which is best, that which is most life-giving, I have to remove all of those other choices from my life, in this case for a time, as they're fasting and as they're praying. It brings this focal point where they can now hear more clearly. Oh God, can we pray that? God, remove anything in my life that is keeping me from hearing You. Now, that's a scary prayer, because you realize, well, that could mean almost anything. Exactly. But when a church and when a people get it in their heart, no, there is nothing more that we need more than to hear from the Holy Spirit. Suddenly, fasting is a no-brainer. Praying and worshiping and doing those disciplines to clear my life out from the clutter so that I can hear God clearly. So that's the context. Diversity, where God is speaking into my life, and that means I cannot restrict my life to only people who are just like me, who are always going to like everything I post on Facebook, who are always going to agree with me on every political discussion, who are always going to sound and look exactly like me. I can't fill my life just with that. I have to embrace people who are different, because in those differences, I'm going to see something about God that I would otherwise miss. I'm going to hear something that I would otherwise miss. And then this context of sweeping away those other busy things in my life that are not necessarily bad, but to really hear from God, I've got to have a focal point of saying, God, above all else, I want to hear You. But then look how the Spirit leads. So the Spirit does speak. He says, set aside Paul and Barnabas. I've got this mission for them. And you as a church, as Antioch, you're going to send them out on this mission. And here's this beautiful expression of the Holy Spirit is really, in a very literal sense, leading Paul and Barnabas. And they go to Barnabas's home place, which would be the island of Cyprus. That's the first place that they go. And they go to this island of Cyprus, and as they're on this island, they start to go, and actually, if you read in the text, it names a few places. On a geographical level, they start on the east end of the island of Cyprus, and they go pretty much to the west end. They go all the way through the island. It's about a 90-mile journey that they take. We don't know exactly how long it took, but it says they were preaching the word as they went. So they're on this mission on the island of Cyprus, being led by the Spirit after the Spirit has spoken clearly, and not much is happening. Like, Luke doesn't give us any details here on, well, they spoke the word in this place and then people responded, and then they spoke the word here and there was, you know, almost no response. That doesn't mean people didn't respond to the message, but apparently nothing very dramatic happened as they were being led by the Spirit. That's a pretty good lesson to have, isn't it? I can be led by the Spirit and it appears that not much is happening in my life, and yet they are being faithful in following the leading of the Spirit. Now, of course, something does happen, and Luke records it for us as they get near the end. They gain an audience with the Roman proconsul, which is like the governor over the entire island of Cyprus. In the Roman system of governance, this is a pretty high-level governor. He has responsibilities over the entire island. His name is Sergius Paulus. And he has, in his cabinet, he has an aide, a particular person who is right there to speak into his life. And this particular person, later on, he's named Elymas. And Elymas is a Jewish sorcerer. This is a weird combination, it sounds like. Someone who's actually into occultic practices and has a Jewish background. And yet, the indication in the scriptures is this man has great access to the governor, Sergius Paulus. And as he has this access, of course, he's got great influence. He's got some power, some leverage. He speaks into the governor's life, and there's influence there. And as Paul and Barnabas, now here's the leading of the Spirit. How do two relative nobodies get an audience with a high-level Roman governor? The work of the Spirit. The Spirit somehow has opened the way. The Spirit, in fact, has this, we could call it a divine appointment. He has determined that he's sent two relatively unknown people from this multi-ethnic, cosmopolitan place called Antioch to the island of Cyprus to meet with this governor. And they meet and they share the good news, and there's interest. There's this kind of response from the governor that he's very, very interested in what they have to say. And now the Spirit, it seems like the Spirit is really leading, except now there's this great opposition that arises because Elymas, the sorcerer, begins to speak against the message of the gospel. He begins to try to use his position of influence to pull Sergius Paulus away. He senses that Sergius Paulus is beginning to say, I might go this route of receiving Christ and becoming a Christian. And he's doing everything he can to pull against that, all the influence he can use to pull against that. And Paul recognizes it for what it is. Look at verses 9 through 11. Then Saul, who was also called Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, because he's heard the Spirit, he's being led by the Spirit, he looked straight at Elymas, and he said, you are a child of the devil and an enemy of everything that is right. You are full of all kinds of deceit and trickery. Will you never stop perverting the right ways of the Lord? And now the hand of the Lord is against you. You are going to be blind for a time, not even able to see the light of the sun. There's this moment of confrontation. And Paul begins to peel back the layers here. And he says, look, I know that we're led by the Spirit. I know that we're right where we should be, even though I can't explain why God wouldn't have already cleared the way of any opposition. But he's put us into this position in this place. And now Paul, by the Holy Spirit, calls out Elymas and this opposition that he brings. Have you ever prayed for the Holy Spirit to lead you? Oh, Spirit, lead me. I don't know what decision to make. I want to make your choice, your will, God, not my own. And after you've prayed that, and it feels like maybe God, by circumstances, maybe God gives a word through another believer to encourage you, you're on the right track. you're right where God wants you to be. But when the opposition comes, it kind of throws our hearts into confusion. Like, well, how can that be? How could it be that I would be right where God wants me to be if this was so hard? If there was so much opposition, how could that be a part of God's leading in my life? But we see it right here. We see it right here. Maybe the Spirit, I was thinking about this with the whole COVID-19 thing. I mean, things, it felt like God was really doing some great things, and then COVID-19 comes and everything kind of shuts down. Did you feel like you were being led by God, led by the Spirit, and then all of this kind of put a stop to it somehow? Don't believe that, because I believe in the same way that what's happening here, the opposition is not actually a sign that you're off track. The opposition is a sign that you're exactly on track where the Holy Spirit is leading you. Why? Because it's a spiritual battle. I mean, the scriptures are so, Jesus himself, over and over again, he continually shows his disciples, you're going into battle. I'm leading you into battle here. There is a spiritual war that is happening, and it's under the physical surface that we see of everything, but that spiritual war is very real, and it's constantly ongoing. And when I call you to follow me, Jesus says, make no mistake about it, you are entering into the all-time world war. You are entering into this battle against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. And when that happens, you recognize, well, this isn't unusual. This is exactly what I should expect. If I am now walking in the kingdom of God that has come, the kingdom of God has broken into the kingdoms of human beings on this world. And as that battle begins to take place, there's a few things to really recognize here. And Paul does it. It doesn't sound like it at first, because you're like, wow, that doesn't sound very Christian of Paul, does it? You're an enemy of the, you're a child of the devil. You're an enemy of all that's right. And that doesn't sound very nice. And yet Paul is trying to point out there's more happening here than meets the eye. There's actually spiritual forces of evil. And Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. He came to destroy those works. And now he says, as the Father has sent me into this battle, I'm sending you, but not alone. I'm sending you, the Spirit is going to lead you into battle, and that means into opposition. Notice that the real enemy here is not Elymas. And you say, well, Paul said he's the enemy of all that's right. He is, but he's only saying only in the sense that he's being used as a pawn, as someone who's enslaved to these dark spiritual forces. And the real enemy of our life is not, Ephesians 6 tells us this, it's not flesh and blood. The real problems in our life are not the people in your life who are somehow making your life miserable. That is not your enemy. It's not flesh and blood. And Paul then shows this, I think, I see the mercy of God. You're like, where's the mercy of God in that text? Here's where it is. God in his mercy could, as his people are being led by the Spirit, simply strike Elymas down. He could just kill him on the spot. I'll remove this battle of evil here. I'll remove it completely. But God has a love even for Elymas. And I see it in the temporary form of judgment that he gives to Elymas. He presents Elymas with an opportunity to repent, because Paul says, you're going to be blind. You won't even be able to see the light of the sun. And it says specifically, Luke mentions this, that Elymas, when this happens, the judgment of God comes upon him, but it's a merciful judgment, because now he can't see. He has to be led by someone. Someone has to take him by the hand and lead him. Do you know what kind of reversal that is for someone who is in a very proud, powerful position that he was in, to suddenly he can't even get to the next room without someone leading him? He can't see anything. And it's this judgment that not only reveals to Elymas, there's a God who's calling you to repent, and there's opportunity for you to repent. It's a temporary judgment for a time, Paul says. You won't be able to see. This is opportunity for him to repent by the mercy of God. But it also reveals this. When this happens, that's the turning point for Sergius Paulus. Because in that moment, Sergius Paulus, who's known Elymas for we don't know how long, but he's trusted him, and he sees that there's a greater power than what Elymas has been tapping into. a much greater power, far superior in every way, and tying that to the message of the gospel. There is a God, and he is awesome and holy and mighty, but he has come near to sinners and loves them and made every way possible for sinners to be saved. It connects. It just hits him. He sees his Elymas, who's now blind, and that's the turning point. And here's the beauty of it. God will take the very opposition of our lives and use it, not just to remove it, he'll actually use it to reveal in greater measures the wonder and the truth of the gospel. Because that's the turning point for Sergius Paulus. What happens to Elymas? And so the opposition is flipped on its head, and suddenly it becomes the entry point for someone to receive Christ and to be saved. We have tremendous reason to be hopeful, to know any opposition that you face in your life right now is actually an opportunity, as you're led by the Spirit, to know, okay, God, this is not abnormal. I should expect this in a spiritual battle, but also that you will turn this very opposition into salvation. You won't have to just remove it, you're going to transform it. And in that transformation, we have the greatest possible hope. There's no opposition that you can experience in your life that God cannot transform into a saving opportunity. And so we have great hope in our God. I'll close with this illustration from a real life. His name was Adoniram Judson, which sounds like, wow, that's quite the name. I don't hear that very often. He's actually, there's a college, it's actually a university now, Judson College, Judson University in Illinois, was named after Adoniram Judson, who was the first, I believe, Baptist missionary from the States out into the world. He lived in the early 1800s, and Adoniram grew up in a Christian family. His father was a believer, his mother was a believer, and he was a believer at first, but when he went off to college, his faith was challenged. And there was a particular friend that he met at college. His name was Jacob Eames. And Jacob was a philosopher, and he was a skeptic, and he began to sway Adoniram away from his faith, basically ridiculing anyone who said that there was a personal God who desired relationship in a personal way with his people. And he ridiculed that as childish and out of date and wasn't up to speed with where things were at as the Enlightenment was really taking hold. And he used that as leverage, and Adoniram began to fall away, and to the point where he renounced his faith. Adoniram in college said, I cannot believe in a God like this anymore. My friend Jacob Eames has made it abundantly clear it's ridiculous. And so Adoniram's goal in his life shifted, and at one point he decided he wanted to be either an actor or a writer, and so he headed off to New York City to do that. He was in Plymouth, Massachusetts, was his hometown. He went off to New York City to try to make a successful career, but he became disillusioned after a little bit of time, and he decided he was going to come back home because he wasn't sure what else to do. And on his way back home from New York City, he stopped at an inn. And at this inn, he was hoping to get a good night's sleep, but that didn't happen because in the room next to him, it sounded like a very old man who was in the last throes of life, who was dying. And all night long, this old man was moaning and groaning in agony and pain, it sounded like. But what really kept Adoniram awake all night was that the man in this desperate situation kept saying one word over and over and over again, and the word was lost, lost. In the final moments of his life, a man is saying lost, lost. He didn't get much sleep, but the next morning he asked the innkeeper, he said, I'm just wondering how that old man did in the room next to me. It didn't sound like he was going to make it. And the innkeeper said, no, he passed away last night, actually. He said, I'm sorry to hear that. And the innkeeper said, but he wasn't an old man. And Adoniram said, well, how old was he? He said, he's a fairly young man, about your age. And Adoniram asked, what's the name of this man who passed away last night? And the innkeeper said, Jacob Eames. And the man who died in the room next to Adoniram was his college buddy. He hadn't seen him for some time after he had gone off to New York City. He didn't expect to see him at all in this just kind of random traveling back home, but ended up in the same place. And in that night, hearing now he knows his friend, Jacob Eames, the philosopher skeptic, but in that moment where he faces eternity, realizes that he's lost, Adoniram, it cut his heart. And he realized all that my friend who opposed this faith in Christ believed was wrong. It was proven wrong. It was revealed wrong in his last moments of life. And Adoniram began this journey back to faith in Christ. This beautiful expression of how God takes even the opposition of our life and reveals the truth of the gospel. And it's powerful and it's real. And the people of God who listen for the Holy Spirit to speak and then act on it and then are led actively by the Holy Spirit, when we face opposition, and we will, as we present the gospel in a world that is battling against the forces, dark forces of evil, we know that opposition has no chance to overcome our God. And in fact, God will take the very opposition that you and I experience right now, whatever it is, and God is able to take that and transform it to reveal his glory. And I pray that you and I are filled with that hope and that truth so that we will listen for the Spirit and be led by the Spirit. Let's pray. Oh God, thank you for your word, which is true, and it's not just conceptual. It shows us the real lives of real people who were sinners like us, who were imperfect like us, but could really hear you speak and could act on that in obedience. And then, God, to know that you lead the way into whatever battles or opposition that we face. And God, help us to believe then that you have power to transform that opposition, not just to remove it, but to transform for your glory. And God, as we continue to walk with you then, that we would have a confidence. I pray a hope and a confidence that goes with us by your Spirit. Thank you, God, for working in our lives in all of these kinds of ways. We believe it now as it was then, and we give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, church, it's a blessing to be able to come to you online and share today. And I just pray as we worship through this closing praise song that you will be filled by the Holy Spirit. Listen for him each day and be led by the Spirit for his glory, for the good of other people, for our joy. In Jesus' name, amen. Great to see you, church.
No, don't give up. There is hope. There is always hope. Yeah, there is peace in the storm. In the storm. No, don't forget. He is Lord. He is Lord of all. King of glory, there is a God who saves, one who is strong and mighty, freedom is in his name. Open the gates of heaven, lift up a shout of praise. There is a lion roaring, Jesus the King of glory. So lift your eyes, stand in awe, stand in. Shout of praise, there is a lion roaring, Jesus the King of glory.
Yeah.
When nations bow and mountains shake at the sound of just one name, over all Jesus reigns, He reigns. I know. Strong.